Welcome to the Babbel World Cup recap show. Because the group stages, the absolute complete chaos that was the group stages of the 2018 World Cup are complete. Today is our rest day. Myself and Brendan had a text from a certain member of the group this morning who didn't know what to do with himself because there was no football on. And Mr. McGill here. How are you both boys, by the way?
Good, very warm, but good.
Yeah, we're in the middle of a heat wave in Ireland, and we don't want to complain because it usually rains here, but I've had enough of it being this warm already. If the temperature could drop a wee tiny bit, I'd be dead on. How are you coping, Jake?
Well, given that the hose pipe ban has come in, instead of it out watering your garden, you want to be sitting watching a sports ball.
Exactly, and I didn't even teach him to do that, so that's class. You've probably seen, like, if you follow us on Twitter or maybe on our Facebook, as me, I personally think this World Cup has been absolutely mental. Like, it's been my favourite, I can remember, and this is only the group stages. What do you both think? Like, I'll let you go first, Jake. How have you found it?
I think it's, you know, I suppose the biggest shock, in a sense, that I've seen in this World Cup is that Japan, who I suppose everyone underrated, coming out of that group. At one stage, you know, top in the group, and then Colombia scored, and you know, they still got through on fair play, you know, because they had two less yellow cards than Senegal. Like, and I was very disappointed because I wanted to see an African team. Egypt hadn't gone well at all, obviously, you know, struggling without their talisman being fully fit. And Senegal were that live wire team that you wanted to see in the last 16. Probably would have caused some problems, whoever they faced. Unfortunately, it didn't work out for them, and they got two extra yellow cards and they're on their way home, you know. But good to see Japan through, you know, as well. Like, so that would be my biggest shock. Obviously, it's foregoing the one that's the most obvious in Germany. But after the first game, you know, Germany were...
They weren't great.
They were destined to go home, you know.
What about you, Brent? Have you enjoyed the group stages so far?
Please. Yes. I think actually it's been very entertaining. Like, we haven't seen a lot of boring games. Yes, you can point out France Denmark, which was maybe boring enough for the whole of the group stages put together. Like,
but only 0-0.
Yeah, and it shows you that we've had goals, and goals are what make football entertaining. Like, going into it, you would have maybe thought some of the smaller teams, if I can call them that, would sit back a lot more. But we saw some of those teams come out against the so-called bigger boys, and that was really refreshing, I thought. Like, that was the good thing about this group stage.
I was really impressed with Iran.
Really? Yeah.
They ran Portugal very, very close. I enjoyed the refereeing decisions. One of us in this sofa did not enjoy the referee decisions, but I really enjoyed them. I thought they were brilliant. And that, if you watch the Iran-Portugal game where the poor referee just lost a run of himself completely. Like, I actually felt sorry for him because he didn't know who to give what decision to, and he tried to even it up, and then he actually ended up not evening it up, and then it looked like he's going to cost people a game, or cost, like, Ronaldo, like, he could have been sent off or whatever, and could have been a penalty here, and maybe there shouldn't have been a penalty there. It was just bonkers. But that sort of added to the whole group stages. It felt like it's just been chaos.
And people were saying, VAR is a big part of it as well. Like, and people were saying, like, VAR would take out that sort of controversy and the entertaining part of it, like, but it's actually added more. And it just shows you that all these decisions are subjective. Like,
that's it. And would it even be a World Cup game anymore if a player couldn't do this after a tackle in the box, or like a late challenge, you know? But that's the joys of it. And it's still, you know, people thought that without the humanity of the referee being, I suppose, with his humanity being taken away by the VAR, that, you know, the entertainment levels just wouldn't be as good or as high. But surely we can reassure that VAR actually creates more drama than taken anyway.
Is that, like, sometimes it's more than 2 or 3 minutes where, like, everyone's trying to see what's going on, and then you at home see what's happening because you see it first away, and then obviously the crowd see what's happening, and then it's like in that Iran Portugal game, the Iran players were telling the referee or the fans to come on and cheer, and then you give them the decision, and I was loving it because, like, it was just complete madness. But yeah, I think that's added to it. Then you have a bit late goals and different dramas. We had Germany scoring an unbelievable free kick against against Sweden from Tony Cruz, which was amazing. And the next day you hear about the man's bet, the fellow that had the bet on was Sky Sports, so many goals or something, or goal outside the box, and then it actually just gone inside the box by the time he hit it. And then Germany just fell apart against South Korea and deserved to get beat by South Korea.
Yeah, you know, and the amount of chances that South Korea had before they actually took the lead from that VAR clarified goal again, you know, was brilliant. I suppose coming back to Brendan's point there on how lesser teams, as we would call them, actually attacked, you know, I suppose Iceland really set the tone for that in the game against Argentina. They had a brilliant chance before Argentina went 1-0 up. They didn't take it. Argentina score the goal. Aguero scored it.
Mm-hmm.
And then they get an equaliser a few minutes later. And like, this is Iceland taking on the might of Argentina and actually getting a draw now. Of course, they've left the competition since. Argentina were lucky enough to follow them. But that is just what football is made of. No matter how many people you have to choose from or what, I suppose, history you have in this game, it's all about 90 minutes and performing in those 90 minutes.
That was a really, really good performance by Iceland, actually. Yeah. That was one of the better performances of the World Cup.
And, like, you're talking about Argentina, like, who you have to choose from, but part of that as well is who you choose from that group, because...
Serious questions about Sampaoli's decisions, yeah.
Yeah, the choices he's made are questionable at best,
yeah.
So far, I think.
I think he obviously won the other night against Nigeria, an unbelievable goal from Lionel Messi, and then Rojo scores with 85 minutes on the clock. I thought Victor Moses' penalty was unreal as well.
Yeah.
He was like, but yeah, he has seemed to get. He seems to just, even though he got more or less right. I thought they looked a bit better the other night, Argentina, but then he still had Higuain in there. That just like, Higuain scores plenty of goals for Juventus, and he has done for Argentina. But it's just something about Higuain. I just don't think he's at that level, or I think Dybala has shown that he can go to that level.
I think we're sort of talking there about the whole idea of, again, and it's similar, Higuain, I'm not saying Higuain and Vardy are a similar level of player, but they suit club football much better than they do international football, given its nature and its tightness, its caginess. And I think that Sampaoli's decisions, you know, have just been totally uncalled for, in the sense that, you know, he's got Javier Mascherano as his midfield general, who's expecting to play like Andres Iniesta, and Mascherano's never been that sort of player. You know, he's expecting him to link the football, to link the play between the defence and the attacking midfielders and obviously the forwards, and there just seems a total breakdown in that whole Argentine side, you know. So I think major changes need to be made if they're going to actually compete with France, to be honest.
Yeah. But even like the likes of bringing on Aguero so late, not bringing on Dybala, bringing on Dybala with 10 minutes to go against
the previous game.
Croatia. And bringing Pavon on, like, Pavon made such a difference when he came on against Nigeria.
He's played very well in every game, yeah.
And we saw that previously, so why not bring him on earlier when you know that you need to score to guarantee to get through?
Yeah.
It doesn't make sense to me. A lot of those Argentinian decisions didn't make sense, not having so far.
No, and the Mascherano one, I wasn't sure if Mascherano the other night had an unbelievable performance or a completely horrendous performance, because there was times where he lost the, he literally passed the ball, like, from where me to that far place, which is just behind the camera their way, which is, what, 6-7 yards. He misplaced his pass, but then he went and won his ball back, the pass back on the edge of the box, was twice two unreal tackles, and then you could see him talking everyone through the game. I think, so if you sort of listen to what people are saying in the media, especially Argentinian media, if you read it, Mascherano has taken over the Argentinian team. I think the Argentinian players have, and he has become, like, they call him, it's like the leader or something, or the little don or something. He's in charge of that. I think that's why Sampaoli has him on there. He's going to be caught out.
He gave out a penalty as well.
And he's got, like, Paul Pogba has all the weight in the world to shoulder every game he plays, but you can rest assured he will ghost pass Mascherano. I love Mascherano, obviously. I think they should get is it Lo Celso, the young
Lo Celso from Paris Saint-Germain.
I think he should go in there. Benega, who Arsenal have been linked with, and that ball from
ball.
His
ball.
He only for him, really, you know,
he made a massive difference in Nigeria.
He did, and that was his first game, you know, in the World Cup. So maybe Sampaoli is starting to see some, I suppose, of the errors in his ways and his decisions, but look, I just think that his days are numbered as the manager of Argentina. And, you know, some people say, oh, sure, Argentina could now go on and win the World Cup. It's not going to happen.
But we will, that's interesting. We will talk about that and what we think is going to happen next in a minute. Another manager that, and we always spoke about it as well, that he started off the World Cup and everything was going well for him, and then after last night, he felt, this is Gareth Southgate, he fielded a weaker team against Belgium, also fielded a weaker team, and England just looked completely out of sorts. He's got a bit of flack now from it, certainly from the fans. A lot of fans aren't happy if you hear them on radio, on BBC, ITV or whatever, and online. A lot of English media weren't happy either, and pundits. What did you make of it? I was impressed that they should have went out and tried to win the group.
Yeah, you always should try to win every game, I think. And the whole nonsense talk going in, which never is going to happen in professional football, never mind at a World Cup, is do both teams want to lose this game? I mean, that's nonsense. Like, it really is. Like, the players you pick, they're playing to play in the next round because they know they're already through. They want to play in these big games. These are the biggest games you're ever going to play in as a footballer. So that's nonsense for a start. Second of all, I thought Belgium were scary how good they were with their
second string.
And some of those boys, you wonder how they don't get into the first team. You know, like Tielemans, for example, the Monaco midfielder. Absolutely superb play, you know, from him.
I love Basso. I know his main moment last night was smashing the ball off his face, but you can tell, I listened to the game and I watched it, you can tell he discourages teams because he's so mobile for a big tall striker. He's not a big brute or anything, like, but he's strong and he's
good. And the onside was good too, I thought.
Yeah.
Do you think that, you know, you're saying they're the good performances, but do you think they really did enough to, I suppose, take, in your case, Lukaku's position, in your case,
Mertens,
is that right?
No.
I mean, I think the first team is too strong. Like, that's what I mean by scary, because though it might be, you can sort of understand, you might be looking at this like double-edged sword, that Martinez can make those changes and it's okay, and Southgate can make changes and it's not okay. But what I mean by that is, I think the second Belgium 11 is a lot stronger than the England second 11, and some of those English players who came in last night, like, won't get a sniff, like, if England keep progressing through the tournament. Like, Eric Dier was shocking, I thought. He really, really was shocking. I know that you don't really agree, do you?
No, I think he's not as bad as people think he is, but from the radio last night, it didn't sound like Jordan Henderson will be losing his spot.
No. And a lot of those players. And the thing about, I thought Rashford was probably one of the better players in terms of runs he made and the work he got through, but you can see what Harry Kane would not miss that chance. Like, you put your house on him. Like,
that's right.
And that is the issue with Rashford that Mourinho has, I think, at United, and a lot of United fans have as well, that they would prefer to start Martial because he finished chances. Rashford needs 1, 2, 3 chances.
That's right.
And he's not clinical. He does a lot of good stuff out on that left-hand side, and I thought him and Rose were good.
Yeah,
out there, Rose was probably the brightest spark, I would say.
Yeah, that's true. I suppose apart from the goal that came along inside, probably most people would say maybe that's why he'll not take Ashley Young's place. But, like, you have to give Rashford a chance too. You know, he is very young still. He's raw. And he may become the clinical finisher. You know, I think there's more to him than there has ever been to the likes of Danny Welbeck, who, just, you know, is not a clinical finisher, despite his great record for England, you know? Well, he does have a good record for England.
He's the best there, hasn't he?
I think Harry Kane just overtook him. You know, so I don't think Rashford has the potential to be a clinical
finisher. Yeah, Danny has the potential.
But, like, you know,
what
I know as a goal scorer, Brendan, as Rashford went through there, Thibaut Courtois came out, I was thinking maybe a dink.
Lifted, yeah, but as Ian Wright said last night, we know how good a finisher he was to whip it quick into the near post. And you could see in all of the replays, like, the different angles, that there was so much space
at the other side of
Courtois. Just pass them on the near side, because Courtois is massive, like, when he comes out, he will cover that angle. But you could just see the likes of Harry Kane just whipping it in near post. It's so hard. Like, and I actually think he had too much time. Mm-hmm. I don't like that amount of time if I'm running through on goal. Like, I'd rather be reactive, like, straight away, do what you're naturally going to do.
The absolute top quality, best striker in the world, doesn't matter how much time they have, true, they'll yeah. find a way. Harry Kane, Cristiano Ronaldo, Suarez certainly. Cavani, yeah, okay.
And the thing about it is that the further in you're going to the competition, the more they're going. I know, of course, Harry Kane's going to come back in, but Rashford is going to get another big chance for England in the knockout stages, and he needs to make sure that he doesn't miss this next one.
And he might not necessarily be the goal scorer that England, they might not want him to be that number nine. You know, Sterling has been okay, but if he doesn't perform against Colombia, say, to scrape through, Rashford could get a shout on that left-hand side yeah. with Kane still playing, because I think he can't play there.
Yeah. He frightens teams, because his pace is
pace, that's it.
I think he's a very good player, don't get me wrong.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's just that being kind of going for a goal he needs to improve, is his strike rate. We'll go on to the last 16 in 2 seconds. Is there a goal of the group stage? Your favourite goal that comes to mind? Think about it. There's obviously like Nacho's that happened the first round against Portugal. Messi's the other night. I think it was possibly mine. Even Yanis the other night.
Couple of free kicks.
Couple of regular free kicks.
Yeah, like Golovkin of Russia.
Golovkin, who's been linked today with Chelsea. Very strongly linked with Chelsea.
Yeah, apparently they're going in very strong for him.
Yeah, that'll be interesting signing. We'll be talking about signings in 2 or 3 weeks' time, hopefully.
First, they need a manager.
Yeah, well, a manager would be interesting, yeah. That'll be a good idea.
Do you want to make a comment about that, Brendan, or are you going to wait until the official line comes from the party?
I'll wait until the official line comes.
Is there a goal of the tournament so far for you in the group stages?
You know what? I know TJ has great faith in Paulinho. The other night when Philip Coutinho picked up the ball slightly deeper in midfield and Paulinho made that run and Coutinho found him beautifully and Paulinho tapped the ball into the net. Absolutely beautiful goal. I thought, like, I know Serbia completely switched off and Stojkovic was left with very little cover.
Kolarov just went absolutely
out. Well, that's right. But I just
have a tendency to do that.
I just thought, isn't that wonderful for Paulinho? Like, he gets a lot of stick, particularly because maybe in the English media, because it didn't work out for him at Tottenham. Mm. And then he ends up in China, and then somehow from China, where it's supposed to be like the retirement home for footballers, he comes back to Barcelona, he's a great season with them, and then he scores that very good goal, or that very good ball from Coutinho. Now some people say that's not the best goal in the World Cup, like, but I just thought it was brilliant, you know, for him.
One of the goals you might get best goal in the World Cup that I love was Yerry Mina's against Poland. Mm. The well-worked corner by Colombia that goes to Quintero and Rodriguez, and when you look at the two of them, it's almost like they're twins sometimes. Comes back and then James Rodriguez clips it in and he looks like, do you know, like an alley-oop in basketball? It was like an alley-oop. Yeah. Like, you never see that before. It was just like a dink and then he smashed it in there.
And England's well worked free kick as well.
They've been brilliant in set pieces.
Yeah.
And Maguire's been the pivot of that, you know, because last time he came on actually against Belgium, he made a massive difference, you know. Yeah. He was actually a player in the defence who could carry the ball out into midfield.
My goal so far, Charles, quickly of the group stage is Modric against Argentina.
Oh, yeah, that was class. Shift to the body and he left Otamendi for dead.
I would say so far, the player of the tournament for me.
Yeah, that's an interesting one. Modric, I think Coutinho's done very well.
Coutinho's done very good. It actually annoys me how much coverage Neymar gets when you think of the... Like, Coutinho's been much better than Neymar.
He's been Brazil's best player.
By a stretch, like, and he hasn't got half the mentions just because Neymar, you know, kneels down and cries at the end of games. Like,
But I think Neymar at this stage, you know, he needs to remember that what made the brand was his football. And he's focusing now too much on the brand and not focusing enough on the football. You know, he has done a few tricks and flicks with the ball, but obviously he's had a very poor World Cup.
I totally agree with that. I think he's focused too much about himself sometimes, Neymar, and he's such an unbelievable player. I just wish he would just
Yes, Messi and Ronaldo have massive brands, but
that all came after.
Yeah. Do the football first.
So the knockout stage is starting tomorrow, the last 16. Tomorrow, I'll not sleep tonight now. Tomorrow's absolutely wild, folks. At 3 o'clock, France play Argentina, and then at 7 o'clock, Uruguay play Portugal. There's absolutely no need for those two games to be on the same day. That is stupid. But we'll start off with those two quickly, and we'll get through these, because we don't want to keep too much on rest day of the World Cup. Plus, we've got a quiz to go to. France play Argentina is humongous. That's at 3 o'clock. How do you see that going? What way do you think Argentina have found it now? They've found a bit of a rhythm. France have come through the group and have looked poor.
Yeah. Neither have turned up. Like,
no.
But, like, it'll take this stage now where a team have to get together and say, there have been a lot of teams getting together and saying, listen, Germany are away. If we give 15, 20% more, we'll win this World Cup.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I think these games are going to be so high quality. Like, because there'll be a lot of teams doing that. Both these teams will do it. All four teams will probably do it tomorrow. Portugal will no doubt do it. They've just won the Euros. Why not be confident going into knockout football? Belgium will definitely... all their fans are saying it's now or never for Belgium.
Yeah.
England, we know, always do it anyway. Pick themselves up. So there's so many teams. Spain, the pedigree they have. Brazil, pedigree. You know, it's
Sweden, Denmark, don't forget these teams.
Mexico.
But these teams will all be looking at it thinking, we can't win this, 100%. Like, I know those teams might believe there's a possibility
yeah.
to win it, but all those previously mentioned teams, like all the teams playing tomorrow, will think.
Those four playing tomorrow, I am 100% adamant that all four of those could win this World Cup. I agree with you about that now.
Yeah.
How do you think the first game will go tomorrow, lads?
It all depends. If Mascherano starts... then they're going to get completely obliterated in midfield. And I think the pace of the French side... now, of course, he's probably going to start with Giroud up front. But the pace of the French side in the midfield as well, I just can't see... I can't look beyond a French win. Now, however, having said that, the likes of Messi, I presume Aguero will probably come back in from the start tomorrow. They will have more space against the French side because the French are more attacking by nature. And of course, they have Kante, who seems to be everywhere, so they have to counteract
that. I think he has to start Dybala tomorrow. I think he has to start.
He should, but he won't.
He won't.
Like, listen, I think France do this anyway, where I called France obviously at the start of the tournament, so I'm obviously going to back them in this game, like, and all the way to the final if they get there, but they do this in tournaments anyway. And they're slow builders. As I said before, if they say, right, let's switch on here, and if Argentina play the same way they have been, I think France will beat them. You see how Giroud was completely nullified against Denmark because they played five centre halves and they were all massive, basically, and he didn't win any ball in the air, and that is his game. Like, but against Otamendi and against
Mercado,
Rojo,
Tagliafico.
He's winning balls in the air all day long, and you know how dodgy that Argentina
is. Going to just feed off those.
Mbappe.
Mbappe.
Good too. Like, but the thing is, both forward options for Argentina and France are ridiculously good, but for France's defence is much better.
I think they're more balanced defence.
And their midfield as well. Argentina's midfield has been non-existent so far. I mean, look at if Kante turns up, which he usually does, and then if Pogba comes in refreshed as well.
Tolisso most likely would be, yeah.
Yeah. I look, this World Cup has been that mad. I have a funny feeling we're going to get an Argentina-Brazil semi-final. Basis on that, otherwise probably because I want it the most. I'm fully buying Mexico and Colombia, like those. We're bound to get penalties at some point tomorrow, not only because of VAR, but actually some penalty shootout.
Yeah.
I think Argentina will win. This French team, like, it's up to them to click, and they haven't done it yet. They've been a bit of a letdown. I know they come through the group and they're unbeaten, but like, I've been watching all the games hoping that they finally click and explode, because if they do click and explode, this World Cup's theirs to win, in my opinion. Like, I know Brazil are very strong and Spain are still in it and the teams we've talked about, but that French team, if they finally click and gel and get going, then there's going to be no stopping them.
I think France are the team, maybe along with Belgium, who all their players are at an age where they're all peaking. Spain, you could argue, are aging. And there's teams, Germany were aging as well, I would say. And there's teams that are maybe too much in their infancy. Probably England is one of them.
Nigeria were
definitely
one. Yeah, very good in the next World Cup.
So, and Argentina are probably aging too, like when you look through their spine. So I that's the reason I think France, like, but as you say, anything can happen. Like.
Yeah, and look, I would love, I would really love, Argentina, either Argentina, Brazil, or Argentina. I would love Mexico to get through and get that fifth game that they're dying for. So that'll be tough then against Brazil. We'll talk about that in a minute. But there's something, I just think the way it went the other night, and the fact there's like 10 billion Argentinians in Russia at the minute, and it's all going mad. I think tomorrow will be, I think they'll do it tomorrow. The game tomorrow night could be the tightest World Cup last 16 we've ever seen, the cagiest we've ever seen, because that's going to end 0-0 and go to penalties, and then 0-0 on penalties until like the 20th penalty each, and then someone's going to bluff it in.
Yeah.
They're just going to cancel each other out, I think. But I think Uruguay will come through, in my opinion. But I think it'll be so tight and fair. Well, it looks like it could be such a tight.
Great Patricio to score the winning penalty.
The Wolves fans can't be the same as well. Like, that'd be mad. We haven't had someone as mad as
I think if you offered Portugal that right now, they'd be like 100% they'll take it.
They'd take that in every game, I think, Portugal, eh?
Yeah. They don't win games anyway, on the way of
they just
the finals,
dog it out. Like,
I just think Uruguay would have too much for Portugal. In normal,
I think defensively they're so strong, Uruguay, aren't they?
They're the best centre-half to pairing in world football.
Ronaldo, really, I know he's talked about it all the time, and you know, he needs to show up, he needs to play these big games, like, but they really do need him tomorrow. Like, if they're going to have any chance at all, you know, he turned up against Spain, arguably didn't turn up in the other two games, really, like, even though he scored in the second game.
Against
Morocco, but he couldn't miss it, really. He didn't turn up in the final group game at all. Sometimes he does that, and he really needs to.
His World Cup needs to reignite tomorrow night now for Portugal to have a chance to go through. But look, Portugal's defence would worry me in the sense that I think Uruguay, with their new look and more, I suppose, attacking midfield in a sense, with the likes of
Pacino and Betancourt and Torreira, who.
Course.
If he doesn't sign for Arsenal, Jay's gonna explode.
But also with Cavani and Suarez, the big thing is Suarez scored and so did Cavani.
Yeah.
You know, both of these players are confidence players. They both got their goals, and I think I would be worried if I was Pepe. And remember, they're against Pepe and Jose Fonte. They're not. Fonte is a dodgy defender.
And so is Pepe,
slightly better.
Older,
more experienced.
Pepe against Luis Suarez.
It's gone.
Just
there's no competition here. I think it's going to be an easy Uruguay win.
Oh, interesting.
I don't know if it'll be easy, but Uruguay are stronger. They're quicker. They're when you think that Portugal,
they're a better team.
Portugal are starting the likes of Quaresma, who you know, I know he scored that absolute wonder goal, but he's too old, like, and he's not going to last.
And that's exactly what a defender, you know. A strong defensive team, no matter how strong they are, they'll panic about pace. Does the pace of this Portugal side worry you?
Because even Ronaldo doesn't have the pace he had anymore.
Not particularly. So they're probably looking and saying, we can handle what they have to offer and we just need to score a goal.
That's interesting. Tomorrow's game's
marvellous.
And this rest day has killed everyone because we've been dying for football. There is League of Ireland on tonight, so make sure you're not tuning into RT. It's probably on very soon, actually.
And by the way, I do hope Portugal win. Like, I know you probably want Uruguay to win, but
yeah.
Do you think Portugal will win, though, Brendan?
No.
Then Sunday, we have the hosts against Spain. Ouch. And we have Croatia against Denmark. Croatia, who have looked superb. Like,
best game so far.
They put their second. They made 9 changes against Iceland. Was it 3-1 up in the end? They beat Iceland 2-1 or 3-1. And from the highlights, like supreme. Croatia have looked really, really good in this
really
World Cup. They'll be too much for Denmark.
I think so. As much as you like Denmark, Jake, I think Croatia will probably be too much for them.
Denmark are missing their best striker, you know, a prolific forward in Niklas Bender. And that's probably just what gives Croatia the edge, nothing else. I'm telling you now, that will not be an easy game for Croatia, and Denmark will trouble them. You know,
none of these games are easy.
Denmark are a side that thrive of making the opposition's life a misery.
Well, they did against France, and it was so boring.
It was so boring, but it was effective.
And they made all everyone's lives misery in Dublin one night, but then I scored five.
Yeah, that's the only night.
Christian Eriksen turns up, it can be an unbelievable game.
Yeah, but
I think Croatia,
I don't think it's
Croatia
be,
too much.
Yeah.
Croatia do have too much. But
the other game is that sees the hosts take on Spain, which will be some atmosphere in that stadium. And good luck to, if the Spanish score late winner, whoever that scores that winner, he'll never be seen again. Well, how do you think that will go? I think Spain will struggle, like, but I think they'll come through. They should come through, but
they should. I think it'll be very interesting if Russia score early. What'll happen?
Yeah.
Spain could really panic, and they haven't looked.
They've looked so dodgy.
Unconvincingly.
They haven't looked so like they're
fragile.
Together as a team,
fragile,
really.
Yeah.
You know the way that you're used to Spain being over the last 10 years or whatever. And the likes of Iniesta not being able to fulfil the 90 minutes and stuff, they know that he's probably going to go off.
And they have Artem Shub up front, who is like a mountain of a man, who will trouble Piqué and Ramos from set pieces.
They're going to taste some elbows and some.
And like, I can actually see tomorrow night, first corner, penalty conceded, because Ramos is holding Shub.
And the likes of, like, I mean, Ramos will probably be, like, the mistake he made in the last game.
Maybe playing his mind.
David
De Gea.
Yeah,
imagine
another
this.
Factor.
David De Gea, high ball coming into the square. He does not like leaving his line. Chaos.
Square ball.
Chaos is going to ensue.
I hope so. I'd like to see Spain go through, but I hope
it's a good game.
Really good game, yeah.
I actually think there's going to be an upset there.
Oh, that'll be unreal.
Russia.
Sorry, all the other brothers, hopefully, and sisters, hopefully you do go through, but if you don't, and it is through some sort of kamikaze pilot mode by Zuba, then I'm sorry, I'll go daft and cheer the TV. Then we have Monday night, Monday afternoon, so we're all back at work, which isn't great. Well,
no.
We have Brazil taking on my brothers from Mexico. I've been engrossed in Mexico the other night when I was on work, and we had the radio on, and someone on the screens, a little hopefully the boss aren't watching this, and South Korea scored. I went wild in the office. You'd have thought I was Mexican, screaming Viva Mexico and all that, just going daft and celebrating. Like, I was just going daft. And I really hope they do something special against Brazil. Brazil have looked quite good at times in this World Cup.
At times, like, they've had many spells within games where they've looked very good, and they've had spells where they've really looked dodgy.
But the fact is, Brown, they've sauntered to this point.
Yeah, that is
largely
true. That's what I was saying about if they gather themselves, if a lot of these teams gather themselves and say, listen, it was dodgy enough that group stage, this is a whole new phase, this is where we turn it on, you know, they'll have expected to get to this stage. Brazil are their favourites, like, which I don't really agree with. Like, they haven't played like favourites so far, and Neymar is coming off the back of an injury too, like a long-term injury. I don't like him personally, but if he turns it on, he can be really, really effective. And if he turns it on, the way that Brazilian mood goes, the rest of them will turn it on around him, and there's quality in there, like, it really is.
I think Mexico will give him a really tough test on Monday. I think the way Mexico played against Germany, if they did that against Brazil and let Brazil have the ball and then hunt them in packs, they can catch Brazil out. And Brazil has the oldest centre-half pairing and in the World Cup. And I know Miranda and Silva are very, very class, world-class level of centre-halves. There's no doubt in them. But this Mexican team could catch you on the hop. Like, they can catch you off. They get caught.
The key thing people hear is that when they did catch the Germans off guard, they made the most of it. They need to be sharper. Vela missed an excellent chance in their last game
against Sweden.
You know, and against Sweden, you're not going to get that many chances. But against Brazil, you have to make the most of your chances just as much. And they need to be more clinical there. And I think they will. They'll probably learn from that massive beating that they took from the most un-free-scoring team you could come across in Sweden. You know, and hopefully it'll give them, I suppose, the...
And Alisson has looked a wee bit dodgy under crosses at times.
He hasn't looked like this 80 million price tag.
No.
That's been turned about.
So, I mean, they'll obviously, Mexico will be looking at that too.
I would take Ederson all day.
That's interesting. I thought Ederson possibly would have started the World. I know TJ played a lot with Alisson in the qualifiers, but Ederson had such a brilliant season. The game then on Monday night, and we'll try and get through these quite quickly for you, is Belgium against Japan. Now, that possibly really should have been England if they had got their act together and if they hadn't done that game. And you'd be looking at like playing a quarter final in the World Cup against Brazil. Like, that's what you want. You want to play Brazil in the World Cup. Like, you want to say, even if you lose, you want to say, I played against Brazil in a World Cup. Like, but
anyway, the opportunity to beat them, these players want to challenge themselves.
Exactly,
you know, like,
yeah.
You want to, you know, tell
Harry
people.
Harry Kane would not have been happy, I don't think. Jordan Henderson would not have been happy again.
No, like, it's all about, I've talked about momentum, I've heard that word so many times in the last 24 hours, but, like, I do agree with that. I would have taken that approach, like, and start a strong, maybe rest one or two, who maybe had niggles, or maybe you want to try out Rashford in Sterling's position, or something like that, but not wholesale changes. I didn't disagree with it.
I disagree with it too, but I actually think that Belgium will relish playing Brazil.
Yes.
They're gonna beat Japan, yes?
I think they will beat Japan. Japan have done very well, and for a bit, to get them.
Because they are an ancient squad.
Yeah, and they've played some brilliant football at times.
They have, but when you looked at that bench last night against England, and you saw Hazard and De Bruyne, the shade of Lukaku, it really, that image switched on in my brain that, hang on, like, Belgium are here to.
And if Belgium win it, God, won't the English press update their words like about Martinez? It'll just be wonderful.
I hope they do win it. I hope they, not the whole World Cup, but I hope they do go by far.
I hope they go far. You know what? They're going to beat Japan, and that'll be Belgium, Brazil. Like, what a mouthwatering tie. Like, obviously, if you're beloved Mexico, don't.
I can see Belgium getting right through.
I can see them going far.
Yeah.
What about
heartbroken? You haven't picked Mexico there. So then on Tuesday night, which is probably the game that everyone in UK and Ireland will be watching, you have seen a lot of interest from Irish fans and how you've been doing. And I've seen a lot of people that, myself, that don't actually necessarily wish ill on England. Like, I actually like this England team and don't mind to do well. It's just the aspects of the media that keep creeping in and are sort of ruining it for us. The first game then is Sweden against Switzerland. And inspired by Shaqiri and Granit Xhaka, Switzerland, they've had brilliant World Cups, both lads.
And, like, you know, it's not a surprise. You know, they're a very talented bunch of players. And I think that, I think Sweden, to play Sweden in the last 16 with the possibility of getting to a quarter final, and I think they will. I think Switzerland will win that game, although it'll be very tough.
Mm.
I think they'll win it.
That's probably one of the tighter games.
It is. I think there's slightly more energy in midfield. You know, Sweden are still heavily reliant on the likes of Seb Larsson, who is at this stage, you know,
even Toivonen and Berg are aging, and then the centre half, who's amazing, he's brilliant centre half. Like.
And the players you named there are the Spain.
I think Switzerland will be a team, you know.
I watched Switzerland play Northern Ireland at Windsor Park in the playoffs, and I didn't see a team that I thought could get to quarterfinals of World Cup, but as they started this World Cup, they're a team that I wouldn't want to come up against.
No.
It'd be a tough proposition. Likewise, Sweden. I think Switzerland will win that. Are you going Switzerland? And then the final last 16 game is England against Mother Colombia. That should be. I think England will maybe shot themselves in the foot. If James Rodriguez is fit, and hopefully he is, because he won't tell the best player.
I've heard today apparently that it's a day too early for him.
Quintero will have to have a brilliant game then.
And you can't risk him, like, because if he gets injured in the first 10 minutes, you're absolutely screwed.
I think they shouldn't start him then. That sort of changes a little bit. I think Colombia will be, I don't know, I think they might put him in doubt. I don't necessarily want to.
I wouldn't be
surprised.
England haven't played, like, of course, like, why did they not go out and just put out their best team and see how actually good they were, win the group? They've got their 9 points out in the group stage. What an improvement already from previous years at tournaments, you know.
It's such a feel-good thing to keep
going.
Like,
you said momentum toss earlier, and I think that was all that. And isn't that like Southgate? He seems a nice man. He's done quite well with the England team, and exactly likewise with the England team. Momentum, they seem to have sucked that out of them. Now, if you look at their social media, the lads are all still friends and laughing and joking, but when the kickoff happens,
we've lost our last game.
They could be that there, you never know. I think they'll come on stock against Colombia.
And Colombia are coming off a win as well.
And an adrenaline in enriching win, you know. That's it, they're coming out where maybe they could have gone out of the World Cup.
Yeah.
Winning the group.
That goal, they've won the group.
Do you know what I mean? Like, so that's a completely different proposition. And if, like, you want to see all the best players playing, like, from what we hear today, apparently James won't be fit. But if he makes that recovery, that'll be another feel-good thing for Colombia. And we know how there's some teams in this World Cup that base their team around that player, and Colombia is one, and they base it around James. Portugal base it around Ronaldo, etc. If he comes back in, I think it's as black or white as that. Like, if he comes back in and he's fit and he plays the whole game, Colombia beat England.
I think even if he plays towards the end of the game and it's tight, because I don't think this England defence will be able to handle Ryan Alphacal.
I'm just thinking the
and
same.
I think if they have
is another issue as well.
Yes,
with his T-Rex arms.
And he parries things out in front of goal, like they were talking about.
And that's
right,
that's his food and
that's,
drink.
Yeah, food and drink, yeah. And he will be even more on guard for that, because it's actually stupidly publicised even more now by the English media last night, that they focused on it for about 15-20 minutes on ITV last night about how what he should be doing, what he's doing instead. And a lot of his parries are not clearing the box on either side, or else, I don't know where he's putting it, but he's putting it in positions where strikers stand.
Pickford has an unbelievable distribution. He's still quite young, but there are times where he literally looks like his arms aren't long enough to save a ball. And that might sound cruel, and a lot of people call him T-Rex arms, which I always giggle at, but there are times we think, how did you not save that? Like, that should have been saved.
And again, like, he went for the onside one, he went with the wrong hand last night, which is, you think
right,
it was basic for a keeper.
But all your pessimism, England are still going to go through. Like, James or no James, this England side under Southgate have been galvanised. There's great team spirit, and I think they're going to go and face Switzerland in the quarters.
Also, set plays could be a big thing as well. Like, England have probably been the best team for set plays so far in the competition. They'll be targeting that as well, because
it's interesting to see how Sanchez and Yerry Mina handle it, because they've been very good.
Yeah.
I think
that matchup. Like,
club.
I think
that's another Kane versus Sanchez.
Yeah, I think Colombia. I'm sorry, Ben and Alec, two English cousins. I think Colombia will put England out on Tuesday night. Not necessarily I want to see it. I love the South American teams, but I think that'll happen. What do you think will happen? Do you think it'll be England?
I'll reserve my judgment for when I hear the news about James.
Okay.
But if James plays, Colombia win, I think.
That's us for our group stage recap and our look ahead to the last 16. We tried to aim it for half an hour tonight, but as usual, we got caught up and talked a little bit more. We'll be back after the last 16, possibly Wednesday night, maybe to do another video and look what's happened, because it should be more chaos, and then look ahead to the quarterfinals. Thanks for checking us out if you watched the show live tonight. I'll be putting it back up on YouTube as well, so I'll be up on YouTube tomorrow. Check out our YouTube channel at The Sports Babble, our Twitter at The Sports Babble, and our Facebook, obviously, The Sports Babble. Thank you to Brenton. Thank you to Jake.
Thank you, Philip.
Enjoy the World Cup. It's back on tomorrow, and we all can't wait. See ya.